Okay, let's concentrate now on these different fields, on these different tabs within the ICU. We're not going to look at all the fields, but the ones that make sense to look at. First of all, we looked at the OPC, or this point source already. The point source of OPC here is going to map over to the list of tags on the point database back on the PI server that have that point source of OPC. So that's, you know, that's the whole purpose of this, is to mate these two together so that when the interface starts up, it's going to know which points out of all the millions of points you might have on your PI system it needs to start scanning. And it does it by matching this point source here, OPC, to this point source that's defined right here. Now there's a problem that can occur if you've got two copies of this same interface that are running, you know, within the same PI server or PI system. When you do that, you would probably just create the one copy of the interface with a point source of OPC 1 and the other with a point source of OPC 2. Let me demonstrate here. So imagine this right here is our point database out on the PI server. And I'm going to draw it like it's a table. So here's a big table. And every tag has a tag name. It's got a, you know, a zero and a span and all the other things that you'd associate with a tag. And then, of course, one of the things that it has is this thing called point source. So imagine we've got tag 1 through tag 3 million. And with all these tags, you know, we need this point source here to identify which ones to start scanning. So if tag 1 is scanned by the first copy of the interface, we would call that a point source of OPC 1. We would define it in ICU as OPC 1. And then when it starts up, it would look for any tags that have that point source. This tag 2 might be OPC 2. This tag 3 might be back to OPC 1 again. Tag 4 might be scanned also by OPC 1. But the point is that as you bring these things up and running, if they write any messages to the message log, they're all going to be written with the same interface name. They're all going to be written as, well, this is on the OPC interface. We really don't write the point source into the message log, so you're not really going to know the difference between, you know, the tags whose messages are being written by this interface versus a different interface, the other OPC interface. So what we have in that case, we have another field. It's a field called ID. Now that's not really the truth, and I'll explain why I'm lying in just a second. But it's a field called ID where you have the choice to put up to 9 characters that helps you distinguish which copy of the interface is writing to that message log. So for example, I would probably just keep this consistent, say, okay, this is ID 1, this is ID 2, this is ID 1, 1, 2, etc. So that the ID that you associate with each interface, and that is something you'll put in ICU, you'll configure what its ID number is, so that that's going to be written into the message log. Now, I said I was lying, and that's because this really, in the point configuration, it's not called ID. It is called ID in the interface configuration utility, but in the point configuration, it's actually called location code 1, or you'll see it abbreviated LOC 1 in some manuals. So it's location code 1 in the point configuration that gives you this opportunity. So it is an issue that if you are writing to the message log, it's through the use of this ID in ICU and through location 1 in the point configuration that you would distinguish one interface from another for purposes of writing those messages to the message log. Now, there is an exception to that rule, and the exception is for older interfaces. Let's say we've got some old interfaces that have a point source of, oh, I don't know, let's say H. Let's say these tags have a point source of H, and this is from an interface that for some reason, either because of the age of the interface or just because of the platform we wrote it on, whatever, it's a point source that cannot have more than one character. We actually have some interfaces that are like that. Well, that can be a real problem because let's say you've got more than one of these interfaces. Yeah, let's say that this tag right here, whatever tag this might be, tag number 15 or whatever, that tag 15 is actually on interface number 1 of that H interface point source, and this tag 16 is interface number 2. Well, you can't do that. As I said, some interfaces just will not permit that. You are not permitted to use more than a single character in its point source. So how do we handle that? Well, that's where this ID comes into the rescue here. What we would simply do is put in the ID number in location code 1 for the point definition. So we would define in ICU that this is, okay, this is the H interface with a point source of H and the ID of 1. A second interface of the same type that has the same point source would be identified as an ID of 2. And in that way, when we launch that interface, it's going to know by looking at this location code 1 up here, it's going to know which tags go with which interface. So that's how it looks conceptually. Let's take a look at the actual ICU. Back in ICU, of course, point source is here. ID is right here. That's where you would specify the interface ID. So using my example, I'm not going to change this, but let's say this is one of those interfaces that only supports a single character for its point source. Okay, if you've got more than one running, you're going to have to name one of those interfaces interface ID 1 and the other one interface ID 2. And then when you configure your tags, again, let's pretend this is one of those tags, you would put an H here for the point source, and then it's all the way over here in the classic tab. That's where you would change location code 1. You'd make that either a 1 or a 2, depending on which copy of that interface it's associated with. And the last thing I want to mention about this is the scan classes. If you recall, scan class is that slash F parameter, and this is where it's configured. It's on the front page. So again, if you need any more information about any of the switches that you see here, you know, just go to this. This is the Uniint user guide. You'll find it in the download on our website, or you can find it in the class materials. Anyway, this Uniint interface guide has this section on startup parameters. So just about anything you want to know about, like for example, that ID equals. You know, if I want to know everything about ID equals, the fact that I can use it, you know, for these two different things, that's described in this Uniint document.